Hey everyone, good to see you. It's been a while since we did one of these live sessions, live conversations. I am coming to you live from a different setting than ordinarily, not from our place where we sometimes broadcast upstate New York, not from the World Science Festival offices, but from my own physics office at Columbia University. You see this nice image behind me, sort of a artist's version of a black hole. If you can see it, there's a big white blotch there coming from the bright sun in the window right now. But this is a piece by a wonderful, I believe, Swiss artist, Fabian Offner. And I don't know if I can move this just so you show the whole thing here. It's an 11-foot wide version of a black hole here in my office. So a nice little bit of inspiration to have. And I was actually just told kind of a funny thing. These are live sessions. Every time we do one of these, there are always people in the chat saying, is this really live? Yeah, it's really live. And someone took live really seriously. They showed up at the World Science Festival offices here in New York City to attend the live event. But of course, we mean live digital. So apologies to anybody else who may have trekked over to the upper reaches of Manhattan, where the World Science Festival offices are located, to see this conversation. But no, this is only available digitally. We don't have any live audiences yet, although I hope that we will at some point soon. But you know, who the heck knows where things are going with this crazy virus of ours? The year in science really already began. Maybe you want to mark it by that key moment, the launch of the rocket taking the James Webb Space Telescope out into space. I think we even have a little bit of footage of that launch. Forget the exact, it was like Christmas Day, wasn't it? It was December 25th, I think, when this Ariane rocket launched from French Guiana, taking the James Webb Space Telescope on the initial steps of a million-mile journey out to what is known as the L2 point, the Lagrange point, where that telescope will be in orbit around the sun, keeping it aligned with the Earth, which will help the stability of the conditions of the rocket. We did a wonderful conversation on the James Webb Space Telescope that some of you may have seen. I think we have a couple stills from that conversation. If you haven't seen this program, you should check it out. It's quite a lot of fun. We were speaking with another Nobel laureate. In fact, two other Nobel laureates. You can see them right there on the left-hand side. Excuse me, Adam Riess and John Mather, talking about the kind of science that the Webb telescope will be undertaking. But it's going to be a little while before anybody sees any data from that wonderful instrument, as it has to make its journey to its location, and it also has to begin the commissioning process. The solar reflector panel has to unfold and the instruments have to be brought online. So it'll be about 6 months, and no doubt for the project scientists, as well as those of us who are rooting for this device to have a radical impact on our understanding of the world, it's a nerve-wracking period. I mean, think about all of that electronics, all of that delicate equipment that needs to not only withstand this powerful launch, but work under the extreme conditions of space. So hopefully it'll all work. So far, so good. It was really a picture-perfect launch. Nothing to complain about that. And we'll see. So in the coming months, we'll have further conversations about the telescope and give you updates on how it's doing. But for today, we're having a live conversation with another Nobel laureate whose work is intimately connected with some of the science that the James Webb Space Telescope will be undertaking. He is Saul Perlmutter. Let me just give a quick introduction to Saul before I bring him in. If actually, I'm just being reminded, maybe I should take one question from the audience, because people always say, oh, come on, is this really live? Yeah, it's really live. So let me just see if one of you in the audience has a question that I might jump in on. Well, here's one. Yeah. Sheila T. from Oklahoma do we really understand quantum entanglement? Do we really understand quantum entanglement? That's a good question to have picked. Well, it all depends on what your definition, I don't want to get meta here, but it all depends what your definition of understand is. We understand the mathematics of quantum entanglement. We can calculate with quantum entanglement. There's no mystery regarding the outcome of experiments that make use of quantum entanglement. We see it right in the mathematics that distant particles can correlate their behavior as if they're right next to each other, regardless of the distance that may separate them. And so from that perspective, yes, do we understand it? Yeah. And some would say that that is all you should ever expect of understanding. Understanding is a matter of being able to start with the state of a system and predict what will happen next. And quantum mechanically, that is something that we're able to do using the kinds of mathematics that quantum students of quantum mechanics learn in undergraduate school. So it's not even something that's particularly heady. It doesn't even require graduate understanding. But if you then ask me, as I suspect this is what the import of the question really is, do we understand quantum mechanics in our bones, right? Do we understand it further than that? Again, some would say there is no further than having a deep mathematical understanding that allows you to make predictions. But if you feel that you should be able to kind of pull back the curtain and really understand the inner workings of the world in a way that makes sense to you at a deep intuitive level, I'd say we don't really understand quantum mechanics and quantum entanglement in that way just yet. And maybe that's not surprising. Our brains evolved, as you've heard me say before, in order that we could survive, propagate our genetic material, right? I mean, that's the evolutionary pressure that our brains and therefore our intellectual apparatus has been under for whatever, 100,000 years or a million years, depends how far back you want to trace our lineage. And because understanding quantum mechanics doesn't feed into anything to do with survival, it wasn't something that naturally arose in our intellectual apparatus. And therefore, it takes creativity, mathematics, insight, experimentation, and so forth in order to reveal these strange qualities of the world that we don't need to know about in order to seed the next generation with our genetic material. And so, are we surprised that we don't have a deep intuitive understanding of certain qualities of the world like quantum entanglement? No. But does that mean that we're ignorant of it? No, quite the contrary. So we're in that interesting in-between place where we understand it mathematically, rigorously, at a level where we can make predictions, but it's just hard to fully wrap our minds around the possibility that a particle on one end of the universe and a particle at another end of the universe can somehow correlate their behavior so that when you do something to one, it immediately has an impact, quantum mechanically speaking, on the other. So anyway, that's a great question. And let's see if there's anything else. Kartikeyan, MK, will the James Webb Space Telescope help us see beyond the CMB? And if so, will we get a better understanding of concepts like inflation, proving it in the process? Anyway, I think that's a great question that we can ask to our guests. So I'm going to now bring in our guests. Let me give him a brief introduction. Saul Perlmutter is the Franklin W. and Karen Weber Dabby Chair Professor of Physics at the University of California, Berkeley. He heads the Supernova Cosmology Project at Lawrence Berkeley National Laboratory, which was one of two research teams that determined the likelihood of an accelerating universe, which we will no doubt discuss. For this discovery, Saul was awarded the Nobel Prize in Physics in 2011, along with Brian Schmidt and Adam Riess. Saul is also leading an international team of scientists working on NASA's Nancy Grace Roman Telescope, which is expected to launch in 2027. I thought it was 2026, so I just learned something. That team will explore the nature of dark energy, the presumed cause of the universe's expansion. And most recently, Saul was also appointed to PCAS, the President's Council of Advisors in Science and Technology. We'll get into a little conversation about that as well. And he joins us now from, I believe it's in his office in California. Saul, are you there? Can you there?
Hi, Brian. Nice to see you.
Yeah, it's been a while. I was trying to think when the last time we physically crossed paths, and gosh, it was
it's been a bit, hasn't it? Yeah.
It has been quite a long time. Yeah, I remember
for many of us it's getting to be that long for anybody just because we're not seeing each other anymore. But it's
Right. Yeah, no, even before that though. So I remember, could it have been in Paris at that kind of quirky conference on relativity that we were both, people should know that Saul and I, although we're both in physics, it's not as though we typically cross paths at conferences, right? I mean, you know, I'm usually in a more mathematical, like string theory, and you're in a more cosmological and observations of the universe kind of thing. But we have crossed now and then, and one was at this quirky celebration, I guess, was it, of special relativity? I think something like that.
I think
that.
You're right. No, and it's, of course, it's fun when we actually get, you know, chances to, for the different, you know, subgroups that, you know, don't usually get to, you know, actually work together, get to talk to each other. Yeah.
No, totally. And I think the first time we met, at least it left the biggest impression on me, was you were giving a talk. And again, I don't know why we were at the same conference, but maybe because the result that you were talking about was so incredible that you maybe were talking at every conference everywhere in the world. So it was back, I guess it must have been in 1998 or 1999, something like that, in California somewhere. And you're talking about your work regarding the expansion rate of the universe. And I thought we could get into a little bit of that too, because, you know, with the launch of the James Webb Space Telescope, there's a chance that in the coming years, some major cosmological problems, we may resolve them, or we may change our view of things. And we had a conversation with Adam, you know, Adam Rees, you know, just a little while ago. And one of the things that we spoke about there was the Hubble tension, you know, this issue of the expansion rate of the universe. So what's your view? I mean, do you consider, first of all, if you can remind people what that issue is, and where do you come down? Is this a big issue, or is it one of those things that will just sort of evaporate in time and be a distant memory?
I mean, maybe one of the things that is good to lead into this is that you know, the job that, you know, most physicists and cosmologists, you know, are constantly trying to do right now is figure out how do we find the little cracks in the current theory, the current story, that seems to hold so many of the pieces of the that we observe together, and that makes sense out of a lot of them. But we know that there are a couple of things that just can't yet be a finished product, and so we're trying to find, you know, can we see what will break down in any of the current parts of the story? So every little corner that you could possibly measure, where you can compare, you know, at one extreme to another extreme, we have to do those measurements, and then we have to see whether they match up, because that's probably our best way of finding what's going wrong. So In this particular case, people, you know, for many, many years have asked questions about the expansion history of the universe. And of course, that's what led to our understanding that the universe seems to be today accelerating. Once upon a time, it was slowing down. You know, and that's one whole mystery and one whole question that we're working on. But there are also a number of parts of the story that you can actually tie directly to the current rate of the expansion of the universe. And that we call the Hubble constant. And the Hubble constant, we've measured it for many years just using, you know, a distance ladder of, you can determine the distance to, you know, a Cepheid star, and then from that you can determine the distance to another galaxy, and from that you can determine the distance to a supernova, and then you can use more distant supernovae. And that kind of story has allowed us to go out a certain distance and then measure how fast are things moving away at that distance, and that tells us the Hubble constant. One route, it's working our way from, you know, relatively nearby out to relatively you know, more distant objects, but to a cosmologist, it's almost local. These are almost things that are, you know, relatively nearby. They're just, you know, a few million light years away, you know. Whereas there's another route that became possible with the detailed measurements of the cosmic microwave background, that glow left over from the time of the Big Bang. And the physics theory is so precise and so detailed in describing what we should see in the little bumps and ripples of that glow left there from the Big Bang, that you can actually make all sorts of measurements from the properties of, you know, is there a lot of of stuff that's separated by, you know, by this distance on the sky in this hot and cold pattern on the glow, and is there, you know, less at some other typical distance on the sky? And if you put that together, one of the things you can estimate is the same number, this Hubble constant, the current expansion rate of the universe.
Yeah.
And when people compare those two numbers, there's not a perfect match. And in fact, now the whole question is, how imperfect is that match? You know, is it enough so that we think, aha, we finally found one of our clues to what's going wrong, that something that's going wrong with the theory? Or is it, you know, just enough so that some minor measurement errors or some slight misinterpretations of how you calculate this and how you do the data analysis could explain? And of course, you were speaking to my colleague Adam Rees last time. And he's been great at bringing forward this particular conundrum by using the technique that we had used to measure the expansion history of the universe, the supernova technique, to get this relatively nearby measurement of the Hubble constant. And looking at that and seeing what looks like a discrepancy from the measurement at the cosmic microwave background.
Right.
So I think you're asking me partly, where is my take on to what extent is... Would I say that this is it's our big clue as to something going wrong, or do I think of it as a probably some problem with the measurement?
Exactly.
And so for me, it's one of the really fun aspects of science that you're constantly having to make that judgment call at every given moment. As an experimentalist, as somebody who sets up measurement techniques and then does the observing and then actually tries to analyze the data, I'm so aware of everything that can go wrong in those measurements that my first assumption in almost any one of these results is that there's something wrong with the measurement.
Right.
And that was my first assumption when we saw the acceleration and expansion of the universe, that there was something wrong with the measurement. And we then spent, months and months, trying to figure out, where the problem could lie. In this particular case, there are a few, this is not measurement that I've done myself. So that makes it makes me even more suspicious, of course, since you're always, sure that somebody else made a mistake.
Sure.
Have made a mistake as quickly as somebody else could, But in this case, there are a couple of parts of the story that I would really love to try to pin down a little bit further before I would get completely engaged in thinking of this as a fundamental shift in our picture of cosmology.
Among
them are problems where if you're using supernova as your indicator for distances, and that's of course the field that I work with, there are now there's now much more demanding requirement of checking to see whether the exact kind of supernova that you're looking at is the same as the one you're comparing to at a more nearby. So that's one of the places I would begin looking.
Right. Yeah, it's interesting because, for someone who's one step removed from the observations and the actual data analysis, over the course of 20, 30 years, if not more, there have been many moments when there were arguments about the expansion rate of the universe. And ultimately, things just kind of rejigger themselves over time to, an agreement. But one of the things that Adam was stressing to me, which I found particularly interesting, is that this may be a radically different version of that mismatch. Because as you're pointing out, you're starting at two different ends of the universe, so to speak. A local measurement, relatively nearby, the timescales are relatively recent, versus measurements of the microwave background radiation, which are going way back to the early universe. And so maybe it's a connection problem that we don't fully understand how to connect the physics that was happening way back then to the physics that's relevant now. And so maybe there's a more fruitful result that will emerge from this, which is quite exciting, that we'll learn something subtle about the evolution of the universe between those two scales.
No, that would be great. I mean, if it really holds up, if this discrepancy really lasts, as we study it in more ways, it feels like it's a really fun example of a possible place to put real theoretical effort into. Just because it's remarkable how well our local understanding has served us in understanding what these huge reaches of billions and billions of light years of distance and billions of years of time going back. And you might have thought that something would be a little bit different, in these other environments. And maybe that's one of the most spectacular aspects of modern day physics, that it's managed to get us this far without seeing a big breakdown. But
It's in a way, it's kind of crazy because, if just based on our experiences, everyday life is not a good guide to the physics of the very small, and it's not a very good guide to the physics of the very big, right? Quantum mechanics and general relativity are not the kind of things that you would intuitively grasp from everyday experience. So when you go beyond your sort of local measurements, you would expect things to be so different. So how amazing, as you're pointing out, is it that we have theories on the table that seem to work over these temporal timescales that stretch from today all the way back to the very beginning? And maybe there is something more subtle in there that ultimately will emerge. But if we can take a step back, if you don't mind, to talk about what you made reference to, your Nobel Prize winning work on the accelerated expansion of the universe. I know you've probably spoken about that like a gazillion times, but if you don't mind just spending a couple moments on that. So this is back, you started that work back in the 1990s, presumably.
Late 80s even,
Late 80s. And so just tell us, presumably your initial motivation for that work was to measure the rate at which the universe was decelerating, slowing down, as that's what the expectation was. So just remind us, why would you expect, and why was that an interesting measurement to undertake without foreknowledge of where it was actually going to lead you?
No, exactly. And I think it was, at the time, it was a great project. I mean, I loved it at that time because let us ask questions that that I think everybody would love to know the answers to. So at the time we thought that the single thing that would make the biggest difference to the scale of the universe and to the fate of the universe, what it would end up doing, was the mass density. How much stuff was there in the universe per unit space? And the reason is that if you have more mass density, then it slows the expansion of the universe down more, and you could have enough stuff in the universe in principle that it would, density, that it would slow the expansion to a halt, and then someday it would turn around and collapse again. And so that meant that you could actually predict, depending on what the mass density of the universe was, you could predict whether the universe was going to last forever, just always expanding, or whether someday it would slow to a halt and then turn around and collapse and come to an end. And I thought that, what could be a more dramatic measurement to make than just go out and make a measurement of a few brightnesses of these distant exploding stars, supernova, and find out what the fate of the universe was. That seemed great at the time. And it also came along with a bonus, which was that if there's enough stuff in the universe to slow it to a halt, that also meant there was enough stuff in the universe to curve space in that bizarre way that Einstein's theory of relativity allows for. And that means that, if you, even though it feels like an endless universe in a space that got curved enough, if you went far enough in any direction, you'd be back somewhere where you were before. Yeah. And so there was only a finite amount of real estate out there. And I thought that was the perfect measurement, a measurement where you get to find out the fate of the universe and you get to find out whether the universe is infinite or finite.
Yeah.
And so that was the setup. That was the thing that got us started.
And so where did the idea of using supernovae as the central tool come from? Is that something that people had developed from a long time before?
It was an idea that kept emerging over the years since people first discovered these exploding stars, these supernova, and they realized that some of them looked like they were in similar brightness, so maybe you could use them to indicate distances across the universe. But every time people had tried that or tried other techniques, they were not able to find a standard enough set to actually make a reasonable measurement. And it was only in the mid 80s, actually, that people realized that there was one kind of exploding star, one kind of supernova called we now call a type 1A supernova, where those particular kind are very standard, and that you can, if you see one, you can pretty much guess how far away it is based on how bright it is compared to another. And so that was what really opened up the possibility in the mid 80s. And then it was just the right time for another reason, which was because we were just getting to the point of being able to use computers and digital cameras to be able to do, on the fly image analysis of data from telescopes. And those two developments came together in the late 80s, and we had just built a robotic supernova search project in the early 80s at Berkeley with the professor who was my research advisor, Rich Muller. And that project was now finding, dozens of supernova. And we realized that we could use the same technique at a much, much further distance if we went to the biggest telescopes on Earth. And we would make it possible for us to actually look far enough away that you could see if the universe was slowing down a lot or a little. And that's what started the whole thing.
And when did you start the analysis that revealed the unexpected result that it wasn't slowing down? Was that sort of a relatively immediate after you started taking measurements, or was that a long, long analysis?
Well, first, it took a long time to develop the tools to the point that we were able to find quantities of these distant supernova and measure them with some detail. And so,
like, how many do you need before you're of enough data to be able to...
Our original estimate was that we were going to need about 30 of them.
30.
Just to be able to average down, the statistics, to get the errors small enough. And in the end, after many iterations and figuring out ways to generate these supernova in batches, we finally, we thought it was going to be a long project. We thought it was going to take us 3 years. It took us 3 years before we still had not found a supernova. It took us, maybe 5 years before we were actually discovering supernova, and then 6 years before we were getting batches of them. Finally, after 9 years, I guess it was, we had not 30, but we had 42 supernova, which for those Hitchhiker's Guide to the Galaxy fans, that seemed like an auspicious number at the time. So we were finally doing the analysis and we first analyzed our very first seven just to see whether we could get the feel of the analysis to work. And the very first analysis seemed to show that the universe was slowing, actually. And in retrospect, we even know why it showed that. We believe that there was one interloper supernova there that was probably not a type 1A that was sneaking in at that time, is our best guess when you look at it today. But once you had the full sample of 42, and that was basically 10 years into the project, and it took us, as I was saying, it took us probably 9 months to convince ourselves that the result wasn't spurious, that they're going through every possible thing we could think of to figure out, how could this be going wrong? And then what we concluded was it looked like actually the universe was accelerating. So this was the announcement that the end of 87 and beginning of 98, sorry, 97 and beginning of 98 when when we started presenting these results. And that really switched the whole picture, because now apparently the universe is not been slowing recently. It might have been slowing, and we think it was slowing for the first half of its life, for 7-ish billion years. But for the last 7-ish billion years, it's been speeding up. And that implies that it's not driven by the mass density of everything gravitationally attracting everything else, slowing it down. Apparently, there's something else in the equation, which we're calling the cosmological constant, or we're calling dark energy to be more generic. So any energy that can cause an acceleration, we call dark energy. And so we believe that there's something dominating the universe, that most of the universe is dominated by that today.
I meant to go back. It's interesting and reread your paper, but since I have you right here, I don't need to do that. I can ask you directly. Because the thing that comes to mind is, like, Penzias and Wilson, right? When they discovered this unexpected noise in their receiver, in their paper, they simply reported on the data, and they didn't make any speculation, as I recall, as to what the origin of that noise was. And ultimately, we know it's the microwave background radiation. In your paper, did you just report the data too, or did you make speculative remarks regarding what the cause of the accelerated expansion might be?
We were pretty data straight, but data centric in that sense. We showed that the evidence for an acceleration. We said that in the current theoretical context, you could describe this as a cosmological constant, or, you know, later, and it was after that that people started using Mike Turner's term.
Mike Turner, energy, yeah, sure, yeah.
For the more generic version. But we said that, you know, if it is a cosmological constant, then here's the density of the cosmological constant. Here's the amount.
Oh, you did. You actually gave it the number. Okay.
Yeah, yeah. And then we gave you some of the implications that, you know, what would it tell you about the age of the universe, for example, you know, that was actually a nice one because it matched the age of the stars that we see now.
It brought other observations into line. So, but when you got the result that it appeared to be accelerating, was this the kind of thing where you couldn't sleep at night? I mean, was it the kind of thing that you were just obsessing over 24 hours a day because it was such a huge and unexpected possibility?
Absolutely. No, I mean, when we first started seeing it, I should be honest about the fact that your first obsession is that you've done something wrong.
Yeah.
So, you know, I don't think people think of it this way, but probably 95% of the effort of being an experimental scientist is looking for where your mistakes are, that you're constantly trying to figure out what could be going wrong this time and what could I see is likely to worry me later so I can set up enough tests early enough so I can find those things going wrong. So the first obsession you have is, you know, can we find anything that could be creating this effect other than the surprising acceleration? And so that, you know, took up probably the first, 2/3 of the year, 3/4 of the year after we first saw the results coming in. After that, then it's the question of how do you tell the story so that other people can believe it and other people can understand it. And so then you're obsessed with the question of, in some sense, scientific communication. How do you explain what you've done so that if other people are going to count on it, they can count on it in the same way that you're currently counting on it, and they can look for where the loopholes that you're looking for and help in that game. So so I'd say that it's only, you know, in some sense, it's a very practical kind of obsession that you're trying to figure out, you know, what do you do about this at any given moment? And it's only after you first start giving public presentations that you are reminded again that this is a dramatic science result. You know, that I remember the first presentation I gave about this, and this was in the fall, just before the January meetings that we went, you know, really big in public on. And the theorist, Joel Primack, stood up after my presentation at Santa Cruz, I think it was, and said, you know, he turned to the audience and said, you may not realize it, but this is a big deal. And he you know, pointed out that if really the universe is accelerating this way, it really changes our picture of the cosmological parameters that we have to look at and our picture of how it works. And that actually reminded me that it was a big deal. I think that sort of it was sort of a moment where I was able to step back from all the details that you're trying to do to explain it and realize this is exciting.
Yeah, it's funny. On a much smaller scale, I had an experience like that that just reminded me of. I was at the Institute for Advanced Study in the early 90s working on esoteric things, topology change and string theory and so forth. And we had this result. And the guy I was working with, Dave Morrison, happened to be walking in the street. And Ed Witten was walking with a graduate student. And he overheard Ed Witten telling the graduate student about the result that we had found. And Ed found his own version. And when Dave Morrison reported that back to me, I was like, wait, if Ed is talking about it and assuming that this must be a big, you know, so on a much smaller scale. Yeah. That sort of thing can really change the perspective.
Actually funny to what extent we depend on the sort of social network of science to help us, you know, remember what's important.
Yeah. Yeah. Right. Right. Totally. Now, speaking of the social network, did you feel under pressure to get the result out fast? Because, you know, there was a competing group that was doing the same sort of thing, or did you just sort of shutter it out and you just do what you got to do and hope that you get it out there in a timely fashion?
I mean, I think both. I mean, we there was a constant back and forth between the two groups, you know, at various different, you know, opportunities. You know, I think we were really concerned about not embarrassing ourselves by coming out with such a major result without having really checked it. And we were not at that point assuming that the other team was going to be doing anything soon, you know, instantaneous, because we knew that they had many fewer supernova at that stage of their study. But at the same time, you know, I think we certainly had that sense of the competition. And right. and even more so once the papers started coming out. In fact, the other team, because they had fewer supernovae, they were able to get their paper out first in the end. And, you know, we thought, oh, darn, you know. But we were, you know, but we really thought we wanted to be absolutely careful about, you know, every single one of our supernova and presenting them, because we realized the community was going to have to decide, do they trust this or not? And and I think in the end, it was probably obviously really helpful to have two teams that were known to be ready to show all each other's mistakes and yet have them still be, as one of the other cosmologists, I think it was Rocky Kolb, has said, in violent agreement.
Violent, that's very nice. And I remember there's like this famous photograph of you and Brian Schmidt, I guess, in a sort of boxing stance at some talk.
That was actually earlier. That was at a nice Aspen meeting. Brian and I had just gone off for a long hike up in the mountains together, and everybody was kidding us that, you know, if one of us didn't come down, you know, they know what happened, you know.
Yeah. So if you don't mind my asking, so what was it like then that early morning when you got the phone call that that you'd won the prize?
I recommend, for, you know, anytime anybody's planning to win a Nobel Prize, you should live in California. It's the right place to be, because you get this real drama. You know, when else do you get a call at 2 or 3 o'clock in the morning, and it's good news, right? You know, and in this case, you know, it was funny, because the call came, and I picked up the phone, and somebody said, "Is this Professor Perlmutter?" And I said, "Yes." And they said, "How do you feel?" And I said, "Fine. Why do you ask?" And it turned out that it was a radio reporter from Sweden who was calling me to get a reaction. He didn't know that the Swedish National Academy had not reached me, because they had.
Oh, man, they jumped the gun.
And they had the wrong phone number. They had an old cell phone number that one of my collaborators in Sweden had given them. And, you know, so somewhere in Berkeley, I guess a cell phone was ringing. If somebody else had answered the phone, they could have won a Nobel Prize, you know. But I found that, you know, so I turned to my wife, who, you know, and she, you know, grabbed the iPad to quickly check to make sure this wasn't the hoax, you know. And but, you know, at that point, it's 3 a.m. You look at each other, and I say, well, do we go back to sleep? You know, probably not. Yeah. You know, I guess I probably should get up and what, you know, shower and shave, you know. And sure enough, by, you know, within 45 minutes later, there was the, you know, line of television crews outside with bright lights and the, you know, various media people showing up to do interviews, you know, at the door.
And how long does that hoopla last? Is that momentary, or does it go on for a long period of time as you sort of transition to this more public figure than perhaps he had been before?
Well, the immediate action, you know, happens over the next, you know, next few days, next week or so. And, you know, the university and the national laboratory, everybody wants to organize, you know, some activities around it. And for me, it was really important to try to figure out ways to get the whole collaboration involved, because, you know, these projects are collaborative projects. And so the end, we flew the entire team of 32 from our team to Stockholm.
Did you really?
Prize, wow. And everybody's, you know, families and you know, who could come. And so we had events there. We held symposia for everybody. Actually, for the two teams, we decided we'd organize ones where everybody could reminisce together about our 10 years of you know, work that we'd all been, you know, working on all this period. So it ended up being, you know, a lot of organization and hoopla first in that first week. And then around the time of the actual ceremony in Stockholm, I will report that, you know, it's probably the right way to be famous, because you're famous for exactly a very short period of time. And then you come home and nobody knows who you are. So it's great. You know, in Sweden, the Nobel Prize is really taken seriously in a way that that I haven't even seen in the United States, where the entire week of the Nobel ceremonies, they're showing on television all the documentaries about the work. You go to a supermarket, you know, or go to a department store, and people are swamping you and asking you for autographs. You know, it's probably like being one of these celebrities in, you know, in Hollywood, but only for that, you know, that short period, and then you get to be yourself again.
Right. Well, that's great. I mean, that's sort of an amazing thing. I mean, just taking a real step back, is that the kind of dream that you had as a kid? That, you know, do science and like win the Nobel Prize? Or, I mean, did you begin life as someone who wanted to do the kind of work that you do now?
I mean, I think I was always somebody who was just dying to know how everything works, you know, how the world works. And I remember, you know, thinking that it's really weird that we're here in this world that, you know, has all the structure to it, and we don't know why it is that we don't fall through the floor, and why we don't have an owner's manual for any of this stuff. And it just seemed like everybody would need to know. And over the years, you sort of get used to the idea that we not only, do we not all need to know, but it's probably true that the fun is in the mystery, you know, that we have so many things to try and figure out and try to learn, that it may even be less fun if all you had was everything finished, you know, and they give you all the answers ahead of time. So in that sense, you know, the picture changes as you grow up. But I've always wanted to do research and ask questions about fundamentals of how does the world work, how does the mind work, and so it was something that, for me, it always just seemed like a pleasure. I certainly hoped I could do something fun and big and exciting, but I don't think I ever was worried about whether it would end up being, you know, famous or not. In fact, most of the scientists I know, that ends up only being fun at the end. You know, once you're engaged in something deeply, then you want to tell everybody about it. You know.
Yeah. No, completely. And so coming back to the James Webb Space Telescope, do you have time on that? Are you going to be using that?
We put a proposal in already for the first round of it, and we got turned down.
Did?
Yeah.
How could that be?
It's the story of my life. I'd say that, you know, almost every every project that we've started, we've gotten turned down multiple times beforehand, and bad reviews, you know, for the project. This one, you know, I don't think the reviews were that bad, but these are really competitive. Just slots.
And you know what? Who needs the James Webb Space Telescope anyway? You know, come on. But you are deeply involved in the next mission, right? Which I guess is this Nancy Grace Roman's. Can you tell us a bit about what that telescope is? And in reading your intro, I noted that it said 2027 is the launch date. How secure is that? And is it sort of on track for that kind of a time period?
We're working backwards from the launch. I would say that, you know, my impression today is that, you know, it did get the usual slowdown of COVID that so many technical things did, and non-technical. And so that's why I think the 2027 date is now on the books. But it looks like things are really moving well. I mean, every time I hear the reports from the, you know, that they give from the to the scientists from the engineering side of the world and the project side, it really feels like things are, you know, just marching along in the way that you'd like to see. You know, every now and then there's a little, you know, a little hiccup where you realize, oh, you know, it looks like we're going to have to use a different technique for calibrating this than we're going to use for that. But that's, you know, that's just par for the course. That's nothing unusual.
I think we have some animation of that device. I think it's been brought up here.
Good.
Yeah. So can you tell us what we're looking at and what the primary purpose of the device will be?
Yeah, so what you're seeing here in this picture is they're showing you that the big difference for the telescope is this huge field of view. And so they showed you in the upper left corner there, the Hubble field of view. And then here's the field of view that you get for this. You know, in astronomy, it's very typical that you have one set of telescopes that are very narrow view, and then they go very deep. And they're as big a mirror as you can make. And then you have another telescope series, which are a slightly smaller mirror but much wider field of view, and so just like the James Webb Space Telescope is a narrow field of view and a big mirror, this is a smaller mirror. This is around the size of the Hubble mirror, about almost the same, but with a much much bigger field of view, and so it makes it possible for you to do surveys of large amounts of area of the sky. And so in these animations here, they're showing you that you have a choice of, you know, which filter you would use to do that survey. You can also actually rotate in spectrographic prisms and grisms that allow you to get that spread across this huge field full of detector chips. The other thing is that it's aimed at covering the wavelength ranges that go from the sort of bluish part of the optical all the way to the near infrared. And whereas the James Webb is designed to pick up from the redder end of the optical and go much further into the infrared. And so they have slightly different, you know, goals of that sort as well.
And so what would you say the goals of this one are?
Well, the interesting thing is that this project actually is a bit of a descendant of something that we had been planning soon after the original discovery of the acceleration of the universe. We started asking the question, how are we going to get any more information about what this dark energy is? And the primary piece of data that we have, the primary information we get to try to figure this out, is the history of the expansion of the universe. How did it go from going from slowing in its first 7 billion years to speeding up in the most recent 7 billion years? How did that transition happen? What are some of the details of that history? Because we think that that right now is our best clue as to what kinds of dark energy could have caused that history. And so we ended up, a number of scientists ended up developing ideas for how do we find many, many more of those supernova to a much larger, a bigger redshift range, going further back in time, to make that same measurement again that we did before, but now in much, much more precision than we could when we did it in the earlier days with ground-based and Hubble Space Telescope. And then trying to bring some other techniques into the game. So there's a technique that you can use that involves the redshifts of distant galaxies, where if you know where every galaxy is located, both in the angles on the sky, but also in the depth from its redshift, you can start to estimate how the clumping of the universe went from that little bit of hot and cold spots in the cosmic microwave background to what we see today as the screen of galaxies at any given redshift with different degrees of clumping. And that also tells you about the history of the expansion of the universe, but coming from the other end. So that would be the second technique. And then other techniques also involving things like the lensing of how the mass of galaxies that we see between us and distant galaxy distorts the shapes of the distant galaxies. And that can tell us things about how gravity works to clump matter. And maybe it'll turn out that it's not a dark energy. Maybe it'll turn out that there's some aspect of Einstein's theory of relativity that needs to be updated.
That's what I was going to ask you about, actually. Yeah. In fact, we have a little image, still image, of the schematic, very familiar one, of the expansion history of the universe, you know, going from the CMB there on the left to the current galaxies on the right. And there have been people who have been suggesting that maybe it is a modification, if we're talking a modification of Einstein's theory, because we're talking about gravity not doing what we initially thought, which was to slow the expansion, you know, gravity's attractive. Could it be that the root cause of that is that our understanding of gravity needs a modification? So do you have any intuition on that? Are you just going to let the data speak for itself? Or do you have a guess of where this is going?
I mean, for me, my feeling is that the story is still wide open. I mean, I think that there's we know that there's something that we're missing, because we know that at some point or other we've got to get gravity and quantum mechanics. The whole story has to fit together, and clearly we right now have no clue as to what's going to do that. And if you look at the scales of what we see that could be dark energy, could be a cosmological constant, they don't make a lot of sense. They're way there's way less of this cosmological constant than you might have expected from a naive calculation of Einstein, you know, of the vacuum fluctuations that quantum mechanics has in it. So I think there's a lot of room here for a discovery, and we just don't know whether we're approaching it from the right angle. In fact, what's fascinating is that there's sometimes in science history where there's a really good prediction, and everybody's just trying to measure something at that level of that prediction to see what the answer is. And other times where all we know is that something's wrong, and we have to keep working our way down in precision to better and better and better precision until we can try to catch something in the act of doing something different than we're currently predicting. And we're in that other kind of situation right now where you have to just keep doing better and better. It's actually particle physics is in that game too these days with the big accelerators. So it's kind of interesting to be in these stages. Now, the good news is that usually when you develop a new instrument and you get new capabilities, we've tended to discover something exciting. And so the odds are that we'll still find something exciting with these new telescopes, but we aren't guaranteed what it is that we're going to, exactly what we have to measure to get the answer.
And what are the details of the launch of the new telescope? Is this also a collaboration with European Space Agency, or is this a...
So far, this one has been led very much by NASA in the current round, but with partners coming in. So, you know, there is some partnership being worked on with Europeans, some partnership with Japan. So there are these different connections that are involved. But this one's probably a little bit more than usual, a NASA style mission, I would say. It's funny, this whole project began actually in the very early days as a Department of Energy project that we were working on. There's a satellite called SNAP that we were developing.
That's what I thought it was. Yeah. Okay. Good. Yeah.
And then it got brought together with NASA, and NASA and DOE tried to figure out for a while, and then eventually DOE stepped back out, and NASA is the lead. So it's been a long development to it, and it's meant that other science could come in to the game. So when you're asking what could this be used for, not only these dark energy measurements that I'm mentioning and the possibility of general relativity, you know, being checked again, but also there's now a whole exoplanet part of the story, where the idea is to be able to use the same survey capability to look for these distant planets orbiting around other stars that might have similar characteristics to our Earth. And so, you know, there's that whole project. Yeah. And then there's even a experimental coronagraph being put on that allows you to block out the light from a distant star and look for what's going on with possible surrounding planets as well. So there's now, you know, much more science involved just over these years.
Yeah, no, it's spectacular. And where will this telescope orbit? Where will it be up in the sky?
There is this location that is sort of shielded from the sun by the Earth, gravitationally in some sense, and that's called L2. And both James Webb, JWST, and this Nancy Roman telescope are going to L2. Now L2 is huge, so it's not like they'll run into each other. But
sure.
But they both orbit around the sun, but basically just staying in this gravitationally stable space behind the Earth with respect to the sun, all the way around.
So it's not like James Webb is going to say to Nancy Grace Roman, there's only room for one telescope in this orbit. Exactly. I think they've got adequate space there. And so in 2027 that launches, which is a spectacular next phase in this kind of way of observing the universe. What are you focused on right now? Are you focused on developing ideas for that mission, or are you doing a variety of other projects as well?
Well, a few things that are really taking my mind. So on that mission, I've been putting a lot of effort into the question of how do we ensure that the supernova, if we end up using, you know, that as the standard candle, as we've been describing, that the supernova now, if we're doing a much more precise measure than we ever made before, that we're only comparing pairs of supernova that really are identical, nearby and distant, to get this distance measurement. And so one of the projects that my group's been very involved with and is studying many, many nearby supernova. We ended up developing a whole project called the Nearby Supernova Factory. One of my colleagues, Greg Aldering, has been a leader in that one. And that project has made it possible to find hundreds of nearby supernova and study them with great detail spectroscopically as they brighten and fade away, which is a little bit like a CAT scan through the atmosphere of the supernova, because you first get the spectrum of the outer layers of the atmosphere, and then when they expand in the explosion, they become transparent and you see deeper and deeper in. And so we're able to compare all the details of the spectrum from every layer from one supernova to another supernova. And we found that if you do really match the supernova very tightly, you can get a much better measurement, a much better precision, and also help avoid the problem that if they're slightly different supernova, one from another, you'd hate it to be the case that there is a different distribution of the population among those supernova nearby and distant, and you didn't notice it, because then you would really mess up this precision measurement. And so now, by making sure that you've matched one to another, you should be able to make the measurement robust against this kind of what we call systematic.
And will that, just as a footnote, will that allow you to deal more precisely with that anomalous data point in your much earlier work that seemed to throw the data off a little bit?
Exactly. I mean, that early one, over the years, we had enough information that we never would have made that confusion again, because there's a higher quality data. But it's the same problem again now within the type 1a supernova class, that you don't want just individual supernova within the type 1a class to be distorting the answer even by a part in 100, because this has to be a very precise measurement. And so you want this to be able to recognize exactly what matches and what doesn't match. So that's we put a lot of effort into that, and we're trying now to make sure that we know how to do that with the Roman telescope. One part of that is making sure that we have sufficient capabilities to get the spectra of supernova afterwards. And so that involves both using the spectrograph on the prism I was mentioning on the Roman Space Telescope, but also looking for ground-based techniques. And right now I'm also working on some other possibilities for other space-based approaches as well. So that's one of the big projects. Another other things that I've been involved with are asking questions like, can we find new ways to develop these space missions that would be a little bit faster, and try to figure out ways to have them. I mean, one of the classic problems of doing work in space is the fact that nothing can fail. If you're spending that much money on a project, and if it's a government project, they really, really, really want to design it with every possible check and cross-check, so that they don't have the embarrassment of spending hundreds of millions of dollars or billions of dollars and something not work. And that's why everybody's sitting right now on the edge of their seat waiting to make sure that every one of these 300, 400 steps unfolds correctly
for the James. It's really, really crazy. Yeah.
So what I'm curious about is it possible to design future projects like this in a little bit more the style in which, like, SpaceX has been developing their missions, where they are willing to have things fail. So they intentionally run many, many rounds of trying out their systems, and they blow up, and everybody cheers, that we've blown up another one, but that's because that style is saying, if you can get a much more continuous development process, then you actually, it's much less expensive in the long run.
Does the data really support it? Would you say that if we're willing to fail, we would actually in the end spend less money on these kind of projects?
I think that's been a something that people have been wanting to do for years. So this was proposed. I mean, I remember when the way back in the late 90s, when Dan Golden was the NASA administrator, he was trying to suggest that we try doing these what he called faster, cheaper missions. But the problem is that it's so hard to do in a context in which everything is being watched from a perspective, have you wasted any money? But if you look at how industry does its projects, it's usually much cheaper to waste some money, apparently, because you save much more money in the long run. And of course, the scale and the speed with which you can work is much more efficient. And I think that would actually be a very interesting thing to at least explore.
Would that also help you address the issue that, when these missions finally are launched, they're often using decade-old technology because of the long,
I mean, it means that you have to design projects where everybody agrees on everything 25 years before it actually launches, about what the science goals look like, what the technology is going to have to be, and so it's another way in which you're sort of handicapping yourself when you're doing missions in this way. So I think it would be really exciting if we could figure out a way to make it more manageable as a process. It would also make it more fun for the scientists, because scientists like to work on what a 5-year project. I mean, not a 25-year project. In terms of if you want your graduate students and your get interesting results. So that's another project. And then
Are you making headway on convincing people of this distinct template?
We've just now started to try to develop how you would tell the story. And so I don't yet know whether there'll be a new round of interest in this. I think that there are ways that we could try to get it through. But I think that it'll be, that's one of the big questions, you know, how is everybody going to be able to, you know, take this on board?
Right.
And it reminds
right.
me of in some sense, it's just a part of the, one of the bigger problems that I've been thinking about these days, just as an educator, which is the problem of how do you help our society be able to think through difficult decisions together, and deliberate together, and not get all caught up in, you know, their fears or their or the particular politics, you know, of these situations. And so I've been working with others, with other faculty and other educators on trying to figure out, you know, can we find ways to teach some of these style in which scientists, you know, have approached problems in the world that are really designed to keep us honest and to keep us from falling into all the mental traps that humans are prone to. Because I think that actually is part of the story as well. You know, finding ways for us to think through problems together with a little bit more pleasure in working together.
I remember we spoke about that a few years ago, that you were designing a course, if I'm remembering correctly, right. to do just, and did you carry through that? Is there a course that you offer?
So I ended up pulling in a philosophy professor and a professor of public policy, a social psychologist. So this is John Campbell and Rob McCoon. And together we worked with a group of like 30 students, grad students, and some undergrads and postdocs, and tried to ask what would be the bare minimum set of ideas where if everybody shared these ideas, they'd be able to think through problems together. I'm using some of the best of what we've figured out over the centuries and decades of science approaches. And so by now we've taught it, six or seven times at Berkeley. It started to spread. I know that they taught it at Harvard last year. It looks like Irvine will do this year coming up. University of Pennsylvania was interested. So we think it may spread to the universities. And we're also actually starting to look at the possibility of developing a high school version of the course as well. And so this is something that actually I've started working on a little bit with the Nobel Prize Foundation, because I think they have a ability to reach schools all over the world that I think nobody else does. So I'm hoping that it may be a way of over 5, 10, 20 years having some impact on our world, where people just become a little more able to think together and to you know, enjoy realizing why is it that we need somebody who we disagree with to think through a problem. Because, you know, probably the people that are most easy to fool are ourselves. And one of our jobs really as scientists and then as just citizens in the world is to be open to changing our minds and figuring out what does it take for us to realize that something is different than we thought.
Yeah, and that's so vital. I mean, I've been teaching a class at Columbia that's somewhat oblique to what you're describing, but I think quite complementary. It's all about the key ideas of science, but how they interrelate to the other ideas that students naturally encounter in a university setting, from religion to literature to creativity to, you know, the vagaries of human nature and so forth. Because I feel strongly that when students see science as integrated as part of this full attempt to understand the world, they themselves will integrate it into their lives in a way that they won't if it's just, you know, solve these problems of the ball rolling down an inclined plane or solve this orbital mechanics problem. It just feels distinct, separate, and its own thing. So we should talk at some point, because I love the course that you're talking about.
Yeah, we should clearly talk more. Because I definitely agree with you that, you know, I mean, in fact, we titled the course Sense and Sensibility and Science as a...
There you go.
To the Jane Austen.
Very nice. Very nice.
Because it certainly seems to me that, you know, at the end of the day, unless people really integrate these things together, you know, science just gets lost, you know, and for that matter, rational thinking often gets lost as if it were somehow in the way, as opposed to as it's part of the pleasure, you know, of all these.
Yeah, no, I sort of hate to date these conversations, but I will say that the fact that we're talking about this on the anniversary of a particular event in our nation's history, which I think is intimately connected with the kinds of themes that we're talking about, is really vital.
I think it's, you know, it's so clear that the style of thinking that I'm trying to teach is one which I think would make it much more urgent for everybody to figure out how do we agree on something? How do we talk and find out common understanding of the world? And it should not be that all one's opinions about reality are based on, you know, which particular congressional district did you grow up in? I mean, yeah. It's just crazy that if I was born in just a slightly, 30 miles over, I would believe completely different things about the world. I mean, that's not science, at its best.
Yeah. Right. Because again, that's something that I discuss in my course, again, from a slightly different perspective, which is that, when you think about evolutionary psychology, the fact that the human brain has a predilection for certain kinds of behaviors that were advantageous in our ancestral past, such as being part of a tribe, being part of a group, because groups could survive in battles against other groups if they were tightly cohered. When you recognize that there's certain inbuilt tendencies that were not these beings that rationally evaluate the data all the time in order to come to our perspectives, rather what we hear and what our friends say and the group that we're part of is so vital to the kinds of things that we have a tendency to believe. It's an absolutely essential piece of the puzzle of trying to understand what we are as human beings.
Exactly. And we really, that is exactly what you're describing is one of the things that we've been trying to teach in this course as well, as along with just this idea that, to the extent that the scientific approaches and scientific thinking help us be a little bit, aware of those issues and able to do something about them, it's not that scientists are perfect at it, right? I mean, what I tell everybody about is we make these mistakes all the time. That, just because we're teaching about this stuff doesn't mean that we don't do it ourselves. And in fact, the reason that we all discuss this and teach it is so that we're able as a community to try and help keep each other honest, and that's why we go talk to other people and we try and get people to show us where we're going wrong, because we're not good at doing it ourselves, and it's really aspirational, not a finished product,
So you've recently been joined the been appointed to PCAS, the President's Council on Advisors in Science and Technology. Is this the kind of thing that comes up there, or is that a much more directed group where you've got various issues that you've been instructed to weigh in on? How does that council work?
I mean, both. The starting point is that there's a charter letter that comes from the president saying, could you work, and give advice in some of these areas in particular? But the areas are pretty broad, some are very specific, like, how do we be prepared for pandemics? What approaches for climate change, could the PCAS help with, these sorts of topics. But some are things like, the health of the science and competitiveness of the United States the health of the whole science technology ecosystem in the United States. And it seems to me that, part of that is the health of our ability to think through problems. So that certainly seems like it's, some of these things will end up coming up, in that as well. But the starting points are, some very practical things like, what kinds of things can we do to make science in our government, more capable, more productive, and there are so many ways in which any organization, be it in government, private sector, nonprofits, the whole aspect of how you get groups of people to work together well is, I think, one of the fascinating mysteries of life, along with how the world works, And so I think that I'm trying to keep revisiting what is it that's going on in government and what's it that and how it could help, make the world a better place. I think is obviously worth revisiting from the point of view of people who have been thinking about the science side of things.
Yeah, I mean, absolutely vital. Heading back to the science for just for a moment, if you were to kick back late at night, say to yourself, what is the one thing that I really want to understand before I kick off this mortal coil, before I leave this earth? What comes to mind for you?
Well, to tell you the truth, I realized that my thing about that has changed over the years in some ways, because for a long time I think I would have really felt I would have loved to know what was triggering what we see in the cosmic microwave background, and can we pull together the story of gravity and quantum mechanics? And I think those would be fascinating kinds of things. But I realized that that very opening question that you got just before I came on today about do we really understand entanglement? I think is a great question because it reminds me of the fact that I'm worrying about the fact that do we even understand what the question is that we're asking about. If you ask, well, what is it that we really want to know about the origin of the universe? And you can say, well, first of all, we want to understand that there was a Big Bang, and if there was a Big Bang, or I like to call it a big soup, because I like to think of it as infinite, dense soup, not a particular single point in that soup, as the interesting thing. So I don't want to be too proprio about just our little point in that soup. But, you can say, well, what happened just before that big soup? And, what would trigger that, and you start finding yourself realizing it's not clear what would be a satisfying answer. What is it that somebody could tell you, even if you got to know the answer, that you would find yourself thinking, okay, now I understand. And I think trying to even come up with a good question, I think would be a major accomplishment. If you knew, how would you pose the question of what would feel like a satisfying explanation for the universe that we see? And I imagine that probably some people, I don't know whether you would feel this way at all, would feel like, well, if we just understood what mathematics had to be satisfied, and then everything happened because of that mathematics, that by itself might be good enough. But I'm not sure. I mean, feel like quite the whole story either, right?
I agree. I mean, I've thought a lot about that, and it strikes me that the only answer that I would say, aha, we have it, and I'd be ready to just walk off, into the sunset, would be if one could prove that logical consistency alone, just pure logical consistency, demands all that we see. Yeah. So it couldn't have been otherwise, because any otherwise would have been logically inconsistent. Yeah. That to me would feel satisfying. But then you also come up with, well, which logic, which axiom, so you do find yourself in a place where I agree with you completely. It's unclear. I mean, obviously we know what progress means. Progress is you've got a fewer set of principles explaining a wider set of phenomenon with greater precision, greater accuracy. Yeah. That certainly is progress. But what's the end goal? What's the end state of that? It's a tricky one. In fact, I'll ask you, do you see mathematics in our, descriptions of general relativity, quantum mechanics, and so forth? Do you see that, even my language bias, my question, are those descriptions of the world, or are they the world? Do you consider the mathematics to really be the uber substrate, or is it simply human invention that does a really good job at describing the kinds of things that we see?
Yeah, no, it's interesting because I'm reasonably comfortable with the idea of that the way that we think of the world as being, solid objects. I'm hitting the arm of my chair here. That it is just our way of expressing a mathematical structure, and that for us that mathematical structure feels this way. That for me doesn't seem crazy. It seems to me that they may just be equivalent statements, and that when you ask, what is it that we are actually doing in our brains, we're recognizing certain kinds of structures because we're built out of other kinds of structures, and that combination of how they interrelate is all there is. I mean, in some sense, I almost feel like, what else could there be except conceptual pieces related to other conceptual pieces? And that to us, we call that solid, objects and light and all the rest. So to me, that would not be a disappointment if that were the way that we understood the world, as you say, that we're looking for these something that's logically consistent. But I think you're right that in the end of the day, even that runs into the same problem over again, that there are a variety of different logical worlds that one could construct, you could imagine, and then you're still left with that problem of why this one, at the end of the day. I mean, I think there's a huge amount of pleasure in getting closer and closer to that understanding. And for that matter, there's a lot of insight. I mean, I think that as we've explained different things that were magical and mysterious to us over history. I think it's really actually been fun because we were able to cut out whole problem areas that seemed very confusing to us and philosophically, bizarre. And we were able to say, oh, that was just a misunderstanding of this, this, and this. Yeah. You don't have to worry about that problem anymore. And so little by little, you hone down where are the interesting problems. And the more you understand, the more interesting the leftover nugget of a problem is. And I think that that's actually a fascinating project for us, as humans over time. Yeah.
Now, for someone who spends a lot of his time, at least metaphorically speaking, looking up, when many people of our species look up, they see other things, right?
Yes.
They see divinity. They see soul. They see eternity.
Yep.
Has anything that you've done ever led you in that direction, or are you a brute force physicalist materialist and it's just the stuff and the laws and there isn't anything else?
I mean, weirdly, the more we learn and you get these gorgeous pictures, from the space telescopes and from ground telescopes and you get, but also the more you learn from like the very fine particle physics up through the structures of the atoms and materials, the more it feels like we are in this, huge nesting space of from the very big all the way down to the very small, and we're in this kind of really nice middle position where we get to look at it from this sort of nice vantage spot in the middle of time, in the middle of scales, and in that sense, I get a real pleasure in that, in the intricacy of what it is that we have understood and that we find ourselves in. But I would say that if anything, it makes me just, if anything transcendent comes out of it for me, transcendent, it's that feeling of our ability to understand it feels amazing.
Yeah.
It feels transcendent. And that every time we learn something more and we understand more, it feels like we are embedded in this world of this complexity in nature and simplicity of nature, and that we're in this lovely spot where we get to figure this out together. And it's remarkable how much it takes of us to do it together, that that every individual person who's making huge advances, you go back and you realize that they're building on so much of what's going on around them and what's going before them. It for me, that just feels evocative of something, that is the closest thing that I feel to think what you're describing.
Yeah, no, I mean, I feel, perhaps not surprisingly, I feel exactly the same way. The fact that all we are is particles governed by physical law, and yet we can understand so much and see so deeply and figure such stuff out. To me, that is the transcendent moment.
And I think it's one of the reasons, I can ask you, as somebody else who went into physics, I think one of the reasons that people get drawn into fields like this is because we really love seeing the world doing bizarre things that our brains were not evolved, as you pointed out, to take in. And that the fact that we get to play with them, and until we kind of begin to sort of half understand them, even if it's just mathematically, as you said, is I think it's a real drawing force, for some of us. I know that's really what got you into it,
My story was sort of parallel to yours, young kid, just asking the big questions and realizing that nobody had the big answers. So rather than figuring out the why of the universe and why am I here, maybe I could spend a little time thinking about how there's a universe and how that I'm here. And little by little, those hows and whys begin to intermingle in a way where it starts to change the nature of the question that you ask when you understand more about the world. So absolutely sort of similar place. So it's been a pleasure speaking with you, Saul. Thanks for so much taking out the time to spend some time with us. We have one or two questions from the audience. Do you mind?
Go ahead.
Just because people do throw out questions and they like to know that we're actually live, which we are live here. So George Anderson asks, how will the new telescope help us understand dark matter as opposed to dark energy? Will it give us any insight into dark matter? I guess James Webb or the Romans telescope.
Well, there are a number of different ways that people are trying to get at dark matter. And I think both telescopes, you know, have roles to play, you know, in those games. Part of it, one of the more dramatic examples of this is when you're able to image clusters that are galaxies that are passing through each other,
yeah.
And you can watch, you know, what's happening to the gas and the glowing matter separately. I think that that's actually been one of the more fun things you get to do with these space telescopes. You can do all sorts of studies of structure as you do this gravitational lensing study. And both telescopes will be doing those kinds of studies as well, where you're looking at the distortion of the shapes of distant objects based on the effect of the mass that's between us and the distant galaxy. And that allows you to ask all sorts of questions about, you know, how is that mass structured? And, you know, and can you look for where is that mass in the halos of galaxies that is dark matter? And if you can understand more about how it's behaving, maybe it'll tell you more clues as to what dark matter is. So there will be a variety of ways in which people use these for dark matter studies.
Are you convinced that dark matter is real, or are you willing to entertain some of the more exotic theories that suggest fiddling with the mathematics, fiddling again with the nature of gravity, might be a way of resolving our understanding without dark matter?
I mean, I will say that I loved those theories when I first heard about them, and I keep rooting for them. Just because I think they'd be great if it turned out that one of those really captured what was going on. So far, my impression is that they haven't yet been able to pull the whole story together at all scales. Going from stars to galaxies, to clusters of galaxies, to sheets of clusters of galaxies, and it looks still more like a dark matter. A solution is more likely, but for that, and for that matter, for dark energy, what's closing the acceleration. I'm constantly looking to see, can we, by any chance, get it by some other geometry or some other understanding of how gravity works? Nothing yet has, I think, reached that level that you would say it's a pretty strong competitor, and we just need to make this measurement and we can see whether it's true or not.
Yeah. I mean, I've been endlessly fascinated by an idea that doesn't seem to really work. But in theories of extra dimensions, you can have a Casimir energy associated with the curled up extra dimensions that can act like a dark energy. I've never really been able to make that work. We wrote some paper with Jan 11 a long time ago, and my mind keeps going back to it because it just seems such a natural, but it's hard to make the scales all work. So maybe one final question from our audience. Ulfar Hari Eliasson asks you, at this moment in physics, is it more likely that the next breakthroughs will come from accelerators like CERN or from cosmological observations using the kinds of telescopes that you're describing?
Oh, now you're having to pit me against all my neighbors down the hall, who are working on the accelerators. It's always hard to make a guess, and you have to try right now to take two really complete theories. There's our cosmology theory and our standard theory of particle physics, and we know that both of them have to break at some point. There's got to be something that we're not getting on them, and we're just trying to break them. We're trying to find the example of where they're going wrong, and so we're trying it in two different ways. We're using the cosmology measurements and we're using the accelerator measurements. Since I'm in cosmology, obviously to some extent I made a little bet that I think I could find them. I might get there faster with cosmology, but I'm cheerfully ready to be proven wrong. Any breakthrough will help the other, because I think as soon as we see something that we can cut through on these current models, they both are in play in each other's studies.
In fact, I heard an analogy, maybe I heard it from you, I just don't remember, that in some sense, the early work that you did, the Nobel Prize winning work, in some sense was a nice blending of techniques from particle physics and techniques from astronomy, because particle physics a lot of data. You throw all these particles at each other, huge data sets. Astronomy typically didn't have the big enough data sets, and you needed the bigger data sets in order to be able to get the statistics necessary to measure the expansion rate of the universe. So were you inspired by sort of a particle physics mindset?
Yeah, no, I think it has to be the case, because I grew up with, sort of the descendants of groups that were particle physics groups, around me. My advisor, Rich Mueller, came from that, original background as well. And his advisor, Louis Alvarez, was, one of the landmark people in particle physics originally. And it's kind of interesting, because I think in the days when I started, we were trying to, sort of incorporate, bring in that style of instrumentation building, analysis, large number approach to astronomy, and so it was a bit of an outsider's approach to doing astronomy at that time. But in the years since, it's become so much the insider's approach that now, yep, I sometimes find myself slightly rebelling against the extent to which everything is now very group oriented, and I keep thinking that but you need a little bit of chance for subgroups to go off and do something different, and it shouldn't all be judged by the large group. And so it's I assume that this thing's got to be a pendulum, right, at some point where you go far towards everything being a collaborative community activity, which of course is a lot of what's happened with these big survey telescopes like the Nancy Grace Roman in space, or the Vera Rubin ground-based telescope. Yeah. And a lot of that work is being done in large collaborative efforts. And then I think at some point there'll need to be a little bit of pendulum swing back towards making sure that it doesn't corporatize all the scientific thinking, that you still want subgroups to be thinking of their own ideas and trying them out without everything always being judged by the larger group.
Yeah, right. Absolutely. That's absolutely vital for the creativity and health of the field. So Saul, again, thank you for joining us. I'm real serious. We should continue the conversation about the course stuff. I think that is a potential great impact if more and more students were exposed to that.
Absolutely. Kind of thing. And I'd love to hear more about what you've been doing.
Yeah, as absolutely. Well. And of course, good luck with all the work and with all the upcoming observations. And I look forward to, at some point, the world being such that we can actually cross paths in person, if that kind of thing ever happens again.
Exactly. But, we will take the moment near the beginning of this new year, right, to have a little bit of the scientific, scientists are supposed to always be optimistic, right? That, yes, that with a little bit of luck, this round of the pandemic will be the one that, burns through, and then we actually get to come out again.
Yeah. Yeah, that would be great. That would be great. Okay. Thanks again. And I hope to see you at some point soon.
Good.
Bye-bye.
Thanks. See you soon.
All right, guys. So that was our conversation with Saul Perlmutter, a really enjoyable trek, not only through the cosmos, but also through some of these ideas of science in the public, science in the political sphere, which, look, I mean, however much we like these conversations to stick to the pure science, in the end, the state of the world matters. I mean, people who would show up to this kind of conversation, it is preaching to the converted, but who knows, maybe someone clicking around on YouTube will happen upon this conversation, maybe get drawn in to the scientific ideas and then gain something from the conversation about the ways in which we need to actually think about the world as citizens of this world. So I hope that you enjoyed that as well. Let me just remind you that we have a real interesting program that we released just a couple of weeks ago on the James Webb Space Telescope, complementary really to what Saul and I were talking about with both the Webb and the Roman telescope that we launched in 2027. We have a bunch of other programs that will be rolled out shortly. We have a program we're working on right now about neuroscience and decoding the brain, reading the brain. We had an interesting conversation just recently that we'll be releasing soon about the various species of human-like species that were distinct from our lineage, but nevertheless were a vital part of the history of life on planet Earth. We'll be releasing that soon. And we even have a program coming up on psychedelics. So If you want to be alerted to these programs, you should sign up. I don't know where the sign up button is. It's somewhere. I don't even know which hand to use. It's always counterintuitive, but somewhere I think over here is a subscribe button. Yeah, anyway, you don't need me to point that. I just click on it and you'll be alerted to the programs that we have coming up. You can join our newsletter, be alerted when these kinds of programs are happening. And I look forward to seeing you guys sometime soon. So thanks for joining us. Signing off from not World Science Festival Studios, from Columbia University Department of Theoretical Physics with this World Science Festival production. Thank you so much for joining us. Bye-bye.